I would like to welcome our witnesses to begin our discussions with 5 minutes of opening remarks, followed by questions. From the Accessibility for Ontarians with Disabilities Act Alliance, we have David Lepofsky, Chair, who is with us in the room. We will now go to David Lepofsky. Mr. Lepofsky, are you making the opening statement?
Thank you. There is common ground between every group and individual who has presented to you and every speaker from every party who have addressed this bill, that disability poverty is absolutely unacceptably high and must be eliminated. There is common ground that legislation to create the Canada Disability Benefit must be passed quickly. We don't need to debate those points. We need to talk about what needs to be done so that this bill achieves what the minister said in her very first statement on the bill at second reading, to achieve the commitment that no person with a disability should live in poverty in Canada. This bill does not ensure that. We propose amendments that will. It is indisputable that under this bill, there need never be a Canada Disability Benefit. Or if there is, that there's no assurance it will exceed a dollar a month. There is no assurance that it will be maintained from one cabinet to the next or one government to the next. There is no assurance that people with disabilities who need it will all be covered. There is only one policy decision in this bill that is clear, and that is that upwards of a third of all people with disabilities over the age of 15 are assured that they cannot receive this benefit, no matter how poor they are. We propose amendments that will speed up getting money into people's pockets, because as drafted now, this bill is a formula for that happening slowly, not quickly. To support what we are tabling, and that I will quickly summarize, we've tabled with you an open letter already signed by 37 organizations drawn from 6 provinces, a wide spectrum of disabilities, national and very local organizations, uniting around an agenda of 6 reforms. The government has committed itself to the maxim, nothing about us without us. This letter is the us that the government must listen to. First, this bill cuts out anyone over the age that is to be defined as working age. Upwards of a third of people with disabilities over the age of 15 are themselves over the age of 65. And that makes sense, because aging is the greatest cause of disability. 35% of people like me who are visually impaired are 65 or older, or over the age of 65. They are cut out of this bill completely. We ask you to change that. Allow Cabinet to create a Canada Disability Benefit that leaves no impoverished person with a disability behind. We, in support of that, I say something with which no one can disagree. Disability poverty does not end at age 65. There is no reason why a person, if they get the Canada Disability Benefit before that age, should ever experience a fall off, a reduction in their income upon achieving the age of 65. Number two, this bill should set, as you just heard, some kind of minimum or standard to assure to impoverished people with disabilities what they're going to get. Now, the open letter talks about a minimum dollar amount which Cabinet can raise but cannot go below. Another way of focusing on this that I invite you to consider is to have the bill also designate what the ultimate net income people with disabilities should be entitled and assured to receive between what they get from the province and what the Canada Disability Benefit adds to it. Let people know what the end goal is, and then Cabinet, in making regulations, can fill in the details. Third, this, and by the way, as well, this bill does not assure that the benefits will be indexed to inflation. We call for that indexing to be assured by legislation. Next, this bill does not set a mandatory start date for the money to start flowing. If we want to get it to people quicker, enact a start date now and drive the government and the bureaucracy to meet that deadline. To that end, the bill requires permits Cabinet to make regulations, doesn't require them to ever do so. And if they don't, there's no benefit. Set a mandatory deadline. We folks, all of us, are driven by deadlines. So are they. Next, we've heard about no clawbacks, but all the minister has told us is she's trying to negotiate agreements with provinces. The problem is those agreements may not be enforceable. Or another government may get elected in a province who decides, you know what, we don't want to comply with that agreement. We're backing out of it. This bill should be amended to provide enforceable ways to ensure that clawbacks do not occur. Finally, and you've heard it from many on this, this bill does not ensure that people with disabilities will truly have a voice in the regulations. Now, it's nice that the bill in its preamble recites the principle about nothing about us without us, but nothing requires the government to consult with us. But more importantly, I accept the government will now, but that doesn't assure that the next government will and the one after that. But more importantly, it's not enough to just have websites where we give input or we talk to public officials. We need to be able to talk directly to those making the decisions. And we need to do so with the government making public the spectrum of options to be considered.
Thank you, Mr. Lepofsky.
I look forward to your questions, and I welcome the opportunity to fill out these ideas. Thank you.
Thank you. We do have the third witness, but we have to do a brief sound check, committee. So we'll suspend for 2 minutes while we do a sound check with Madame Bourget. For questions, beginning with Madame Gray for 6 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you to all of the witnesses for being here today. We really appreciate it. My first questions today are for Mr. Lepofsky and the AODA Alliance. Earlier in this committee, Minister Qualtro called Bill C-22 framework legislation. And what are your thoughts on this? Does this concern you?
This term is kind of a government invention for a law which actually, frankly, says very little. It has no legal force and should not constrain your thinking. For example, all laws provide some specificity and sometimes delegate some authority to Cabinet, just like this one. But this law creates no rights for people with disabilities. None at all. And forgive me, but we are a disability rights movement. To add details like a requirement that a benefit begin, that it have a minimum payment by, begin by a certain date, that it have a certain minimum amount and a targeted income that you are to achieve combined with provincial benefits, to provide that if regulations are to be made to make it happen, that there is a deadline. Then it becomes a disability rights law, and even under the government's term they keep bandying about, it is framework legislation. So there's nothing in the Bible or any ensuing sources of wisdom that say it can't give us any rights lest it no longer be framework legislation. So my answer to all is, please, let's get away from that term. Let's talk about what rights people with disabilities should be given in law. And if they're in regulations, they can be repealed by a cabinet in secret, populated by one party. If it's in legislation, they can only be repealed with the review of the whole House and the Senate and debated in public. That is an important difference in enshrining disability rights that are embedded and safeguarded.
Thank you. Thank you for that. You had touched base during your testimony about the concern for clawbacks. And when I asked the minister, Minister Qualtro, about this, she stated it's a, quote, red line, but did admit there wasn't really anything specifically in the bill to prevent this. Is the minister saying it's a red line assurance enough for you that there won't be clawbacks from implementation of this benefit?
Look, obviously, I can't speak for her, and you're not asking me to. I could say that there's universal recognition on the part of them, you know, what the minister has said as a red line from opposition parties, all presenters, that they don't want this to become essentially a subsidy for provincial governments rather than a subsidy and income support for people with disabilities. And that's commendable that everybody agrees on that. But the only way I can think of that you assure that is not just by ephemeral agreements that are negotiated today, but by mandatory consequences if a province now or in the future acts contrary to that. And that's what we need to have. But in this bill, we don't have any of that.
Thank you. The other thing I wanted to ask was about co-creation. And you had touched on, on consulting. My first question on this is, what consultation has there been with your organization or others that you know up to this point? Because we know that this legislation was tabled a year ago, right? And then it was, retabled again now without any changes. So my first question is, what type of consultation has there been up to this point, and have you been happy with that? And then moving forward, is there anything in this bill that you can point to that assures that co-creation will exist if Bill C-22 passes?
Okay. Let me begin by saying that my coalition has not been engaged in the consultations up to now, and I'm not in a position to, and I don't propose to comment on them, because we haven't, because our advocacy focus is accessibility. There are very good disability poverty experts, and when it comes to issues like how much amount or how much should the payment be and who should be eligible and how quickly we need it, they're the folks to turn to. Our focus is on what makes legislation, what ensures that legislation will work and what eliminates barriers from legislation. On the issue of co-creation, let me just summarize what I understand. Number one, the group that spoke of that before you was Disability Without Poverty, who are an important voice on disability poverty issues. And what they said they mean by it is that people with disabilities will have an equal seat at the decision-making table. And in fact, in their presentation on October 31st, I'm paraphrasing, they said it's more than just consulting and engaging with us. Now, I don't propose to speak for them. That would totally not be appropriate. But I can say this. Nothing in this bill gives people with disabilities any seat in the cabinet room, because they're the deciders. Cabinet's the deciders. Moreover, we don't even get in the cabinet room because there's secret proceedings. Moreover, the minister, in fairness, has never, at least in anything I saw in public debates on the bill in the House or at this committee, committed to co-creation. She committed to engagement and consultation. What I would conclude with is this. It is valuable, of course, to hear our voice, but we need to build it in so we really get to know what we're giving input on. That means the options on the table, and that we really get to speak to those who actually decide, not any intermediaries. Now, that raises practical problems because there's a lot of us.
Lepofsky and Madame Gray, you may continue that in a further line of questioning. Mr. Long, for 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Chair. Good afternoon to our witnesses. Good afternoon, colleagues. Welcome back, Mr. Lepofsky. Thanks for your contribution to C-81. That was the landmark legislation, the Accessible Canada Act, that we put through last session.
Madame Zarillo, for 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I really appreciate the witness testimony today, and it's an interesting discussion about rights, and I kind of wanted to revisit the discussion around rights. So if I have the chance, I'm going to go to Mr. Lepofsky second just to talk about, he had mentioned that the amendments would speed up getting money to the people. I wanted to ask him about that.
Because this bill leaves everything up in the air, that means Cabinet has to figure it all out whenever they feel like it, whenever they get to it, and so on, without deadline. Deadlines would speed it up, but putting in details about the specific, setting some mandatory minimums of who is eligible, mandatory minimum of the amount that it can't sink below, and so on, would help speed it up. Let me be clear. This kind of, as designed now, we have an open-ended possible future consultation. There's only three things, there are three major things to consult on. One, how much money people with disabilities need to live on. Number two, who should be eligible. And number three, what do we need in the application process and the appeal process to make sure they're swift, fair, and barrier-free. This is not rocket science. If the minister has been consulting for 2 years, I don't know why it would take too long to figure those things out. Last thing I'll tell you quickly is this. My coalition, with a funding of zero, we didn't take any money, didn't ask for any money from the government to do this. We put together a list of six proposed improvements in the open letter that's all before you. We sent it out. We wrote it in a couple of days and sent it out 10 days ago. And we've already got 37 organizations signing on and more emailing us on the plane here to speak to you. That was in 10 days with a budget of zero. This doesn't have to take a super long time, but left to Cabinet and not decided with any constraints from this committee and Parliament, it could go on indefinitely.
And just to follow up on that question, when you say to go on indefinitely, in your best estimate, without any guidelines, without any amendments, without any commitments or guardrails, so to say, how long do you really think this will take if it passes as is?
I wonder what I think it will take?
Yeah.
Oh, I have no idea, because the government could decide something else is important, or someone could intervene and say, we don't want to spend money on this now, or whatever, or it could take less time, but they end up with less dollars. And so one thing I know about all of us is we work better to deadline. And the other thing I know is if this committee takes the messages on which these 37 organizations have united, and if you go through the briefs and the submissions you've got, many of those support various, if not many, if not most, of what's in our open letter. You've got the agenda for change. It's just a matter of putting it together and coming up with the wording.
Madame Ferry, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you to all of the witnesses for being here. It's Michelle Ferrari, Member of Parliament for Peterborough-Kawartha. And thank you for all of your honest testimony in helping try to achieve two things quickly and properly. I have a question, if I may, for Mr. Lepofsky for the AODA Alliance. There was a headline news article before I got here. It just popped up in my news feed, and it was from City News, and it said MAID, medical assistance in dying, as an alternative to poverty. And I'm curious on your thoughts of if you think this is a growing concern among the disabled community, and the alternative to use MAID as a resource.
welcome an opportunity to come back before this committee in its study of medically assisted suicide, because I believe that that practice has run amok. It was, I believe, accepted by the Canadian public to deal with people near end of life in insufferable, untreatable physical pain. And now it's gone to the lengths where it's literally a new response to the holes in the social safety net. This is devastating. But the message I would convey to you as parliamentarians, as look at how quickly Parliament passed amendments to make medically assisted suicide more quickly, that is to say, dying, focusing on only people with disabilities. I call on you to move with even greater speed to make it easier to live with a disability. And that includes not only those under 65, but those over 65 as well.
Appreciate that. Thank you very much.